Road track. How quick is the ultimate Corvette? Really damn quick. Matt Farah wrote this. He came to track. He's quite a good driver. He spent a lot of time in the car, and I was standing right by the track. This is Road Atlanta. How many people have been to Road Atlanta? I'm just curious. So you guys know it's not for the mile apart. It's a kind of old school racetrack. There's real risk there. It's a real roller coaster. There's a lot of blind corners. So it's not a place to go and take a supercar, a hypercar, and learn the track for the first time. Matt had been there before. He was really eager to get in this car. And I was standing there when he first exited the car. He'd been out for a few laps. He came out and he just stood there. He had a big grin on his face and he said, "More car than balls." that was his summation of his experience on the track. But he went on, he wrote a long article. He says the same thing. The ride, more than anything, impressed me on the road drive. ZR1 is a car that front approach angles aside I could live with every day. So it's similar to other Corvettes. They're low, so don't drive them when there's more than 6 or 8 inches of snow. We had to do that all winter. We did our Dashwood test fleet this winter, just because of when the car was being introduced. We got our cars in the fall and got to ride all winter in these things. We put Michelin snow tires, which are available now in our sizes. And actually, it was a riot driving the car all winter. It's no compromise. It was really fun. So he references the Ford GT. As usual for the segment, there's nothing quite like it. Handily embarrassed the $450,000 Ford GT by accident, so for $140,000. So you knew about that. ZR1 is everything you want out of the ultimate Corvette to compete with the world at a price nobody would compete with. Bottom line, it is, without question, the fastest, loudest, craziest, most capable Corvette ever made, which puts it right in the running for the fastest road cars of all time. America, hell yeah. Andy Pilgrim, baby. You guys remember Andy, right? Great guy. He was great fun to catch up with. Obviously, he knows the track. He knows fast cars. So he was really interested in what he could do out there. It was hot. As I said, we have winter of all conditions. It was cold the first day, hot the second day. So he was there on a hot day. He saw 168 miles an hour. I think Randy's time, I think he was going 172, a little cooler the day Randy was there. But Andy was still getting to 168. Anybody who's been to Road Atlanta knows 168, that's fast. As you come over the top of the hill, pretty scary. So one of the things he did was at the end of the day, things were winding down. It was the hottest part of the day. It was about 90 degrees. We wanted, and he wanted, to go out and run essentially a tank of fuel. So we put him in an automatic, and actually with all the other journalists watching, he went out and ran a tank of fuel, which I think was about 13 laps. Very consistent lap times, between 130 and 131. So he was not trying to go for a qualifying lap, but trying to run continuous, steady laps at a very high pace. He basically did that with the car. Not complaining one bit. There's the CO6's reputation for being less than robust on the track in the heat. This car is validated to 100 degrees here. We put Andy in the car to run as hard as he could for a tank, and the car behaved perfectly. One of the reasons we wanted to do that is the way you run these media events, you got a bunch of people vying for car time, and so we typically let them go out 3 or 4 laps, and they got to come in, let somebody else have a turn, and so that starts conspiracy theories that, oh, a car can't go more than 3 laps before having trouble. So that's not it. It's just that we want to get all the journalists through the car and everybody be able to share them. But we thought this time it would be a really good idea to let somebody, at least want somebody everybody respected, that they knew could push a car to its limit, let them go out and run the car hard. ZR1 never got nervous or twitchy, saw no warning lights. Engine temps remained in the normal range throughout the run. So this was a completely stock car. Like I said, we've done absolutely the best job. We know how to do, and as much content for cooling into this vehicle. Here's top tier, Pat Devereaux, saying, what is the competition for the ZR1? Frankly, there isn't any at this price. Compares it to the McLaren. Yeah, he was super happy. So top tier, I haven't always been a huge fan of American cars, but his bottom line is, we should pause for a moment and recognize that America's best supercar for now is the furious Corvette ZR1. And he's referencing how much better the C7 is in general. You see, saw that in some of the other articles that the ZR1 is the pinnacle of C7. You get all the C7 goodness, and then you just take it to the extreme in the ZR1. Okay, Harlan mentioned big announcement.
You know what it is?
Right. The only reason most of you are still awake. There's a reason this big announcement is such small print. So, our news. We're going to pace Indy. Actually, that's cool. That's right. You guys do that? We know who's going to drive. I know there's been a few people practicing.
I volunteer.
Who wants Harlan to drive?
Yeah. It's settled then.
That was easy. It's settled, yes. Admiral Blue car, some unique graphics. We like to joke that this is the only pace car in the world that when they drop the flag, it doesn't get off the track, it just accelerates. All the race cars, and it's a race. So we're the closest to being able to do that with the ZR1. So here's the really big news. You know how we like to mess with colors. We can't leave them well enough alone. We're always tampering. And so we're going to have a new gray. We've got a whole series of grays here. But it turns out every time we change them, the penetration goes up. A lot of people are ordering the ZR1. In the Watkins Glen gray, they think it looks really sinister, but not black. We actually have samples up here. I think it'll actually improve that sinister look.
I gotta say something about the samples.
Okay.
We've got Chuck on TV here, our expert at paint, our charge of paint, the new paint shop, everything that's going great at Bowling Green. And he said, he goes, you can't just show a couple of paint chips at the Corvette Museum with all the most important customers here. That's not good enough. To bring over some early panels that we painted in the new paint shop. So thanks, Chuck, for doing that.
So this happened while we were presenting. I didn't know we were doing this. So this came together, I guess, at the last minute. So we have two new colors. One is Shadow Gray, replaces Watkins Glen, and Elkhart Lake Blue replaces Admiral. And this breaks my heart. Admiral Blue has been one of my all-time favorites. I've actually been pushing for it to come back. I loved it in the fourth generation car. But we're going to tamper with it and give people something new to talk about. So Carlos holding the gray. Actually, the round of applause really should go to Chuck and the team who brought the paint show. I'll tell you the number of people who've come up to me who bought recent cars out of the new shop, and they say it's the best looking car they've ever seen from a paint perspective. Absolutely world class. It embarrasses a lot of expensive cars it's parked next to, and that was a huge investment over there, a huge project to get that paint shop in place. Okay, we're taking them out of the pace car. Anyway, we'll let you come up and take a look at these. I think that's actually the end of the show. Oh, yeah, I wanted to mention the last day to order. If you say, oh my God, I can't stand those new colors, I've got to have one of the old color. Well, honestly, it's too late for the ZR1 anyway. But the last day to order on the rest of the cars, the current Watkins Gray is May 17th. and we'll be producing the car new color August 6th, and then with the blue, last day to order June 28th, and we'll start production October 1st, so a little more time on the blue wire and the blue car. So thank you, Chuck. I appreciate the teamwork and willingness to go the extra mile to bring us some vehicles. We can put these outside in the sun so we'll take a look at them.
Yes, yes, okay. Please.
All right. Okay, I think that wraps up. All right, we can start questions if you want. You can stick around. Maybe there'll be a question about the show. Yes, right here.
Have you guys considered any different dynamics for door openings, whether it be gull wings, scissor doors, for either the present Corvette or future Corvettes?
Questions about doors. How many people would like an exotic door, like a gull wing door or a scissor door? How many people would like that? Looks like you're the other one. We were going to do it, but we're going to cancel those plans. There's, you know, those look cool in pictures. On convertibles, they're really hard to do, and we do nothing but convertibles. And then if it ever rains, when you have a door that opens above you, every time you get into the car, you risk hitting your head, getting dirty water dripped on you. There's a huge number of inconveniences that come along with that kind of architecture. Looks awesome in pictures, not very much fun to live with. So that's why most people here are really smart and don't want that. How about you in the back? Red.
At what point does the aero package start to come effect? What speed?
Question is, at what speed does the aero package start to become effective? It depends. It becomes effective as soon as you start moving, honestly, but it's very small. The question is more, when can you start feeling it from behind the wheel? We typically say highway speeds, like 60, 70 miles an hour. But if you take that big wing off that car and you hold it, just hold it with your hands in a 10-mile-an-hour breeze, it's like a high-performance kite. It has incredible authority. You wouldn't believe how much force it generates, even at relatively low velocities. So compared to the weight of the car, it's small, but it starts working pretty quickly. And a lot of times, when you're at the limit, it doesn't take a much vertical loading to either have the tire stick or have them slip. And so even at relatively low speeds, you can start to feel a difference. Yes?
A comment on a question. First of all, those new colors are a home run. They're amazing. A question, when you did the 24 hours of VIR, did you have any mechanical problems or downtime on that 24 hours?
No, we didn't, and that's not always the case, but the driveline, completely robust. All we had to do was tires, brakes, fuel, and get the driver's brake, basically.
Great.
Very, very strong performance. Okay, what do I yes, Orin.
I have two. What you said there was chassis differences when you ordered the performance package
on the ZR1.
Yes.
And also, why is there not a weather mode, especially if you have custom tires?
We don't want to imply the car is great in bad weather, but the answer here, it's the usual setup. When you get new tires, sets up the whole rest of the car. So you typically have to evolve the rest of the chassis to the tire. So springs, bars, dampers, and then all the electronic chassis controls, whether the ABS, stability controls, all those things have to be custom tuned and optimized around those tires. That's why you get essentially a whole new chassis package when you get the tires. How about you?
This is for Harlan. You've done such a great job in the automatic. It's now being used just on the racetrack as a preferred, as opposed to paddle shifting, for instance. And it's obviously the overwhelming choice. When's it going to become the standard included in the package and the 8-speed being or the 7-speed being the option?
Do you want the, if I understand the question you're asking, why don't we make the automatic standard and the manual be the option?
Yeah.
It was like that at one point back in the fifth generation car. We did that, but it's an interesting question because we changed it. One of the transmissions had to be standard. That was the going in. So we changed it with actually the sixth generation. We made the manual standard because at that time we did have the better The manual was the better performer and had better fuel economy, and it called the cars up to compare on the internet and the lower price. So we wanted to look for the comparison. So right now it's getting to the point where the automatic cars are getting a better performance and efficiency. So it's an interesting question, to be honest, as the automatic gets more and more. But it just seems to be tradition to have a manual standard and the extra. I think most people think of that as kind of a more premium because it does more for you. And now that we have the tool with the paddle shifting, you're kind of getting to change decision on. But it's an interesting question.
Yeah, historically, though, the reason it's been that way is the automatic transmission costs a lot more than the manual. And so it would be a really bad business decision for us to give away the expensive one and then try to charge money most people would object. If we tried to charge for the manual went so long, for so long, it's been standard, they say, well, it should be a zero-cost option, right? Or I should get money back if I do the manual. Because we've taught people to do that. So for us, that would be a really bad business strategy. Okay.
A lot has been talked about with the attention to detail with the new paint shop. Maybe Chuck can address, you know, a lot of the orange peel questions that have been asked before. The two panels do look fantastic, so can you talk a little bit about the attention you guys put into the process, the new process, plus orange peel, or the lack thereof?
Sure. I think really kind of a twofold answer. I mean, one, when we upgraded the shop, if we would have just built, I want to say what our normal build and process paint shop is, we just put one in Flint, Michigan, okay? So if we would have put that paint shop here, we would have improved the appearance of the car over the current paint shop based on the technology changes that are in new shops versus the old one that we had, used to have. What made it go from that to the quantum leap forward is this paint shop is not a standard paint shop. This is radically different than the one we just built in Flint. And it was built to optimize painting composite materials. This is it's a great surface or a great substrate for design to make it light in the shape you want, but honestly, it's a terrible canvas for us to paint. So what we did is, knowing that and knowing this is what the car is made of, we optimized the process to accommodate this, right? So there's a lot of things that we did in that. It takes us a lot longer to process a car in our new shop because we paint it much slower. We bake it at lower temperatures. We bake it longer than what we used to at those lower temperatures. And then we did.